Rakshachitra madam and team A, I think service delivery can be an important competitive advantage for a healthcare organization. So as we know, we are all moving to...
No, signal is not good, Vidya. Harshul, can you hear her?
No,
no,
it's very important, but it is quite in the sense.
Vidya, we can't hear you.
Okay.
Can you connect to your any other device in your room?
There is something. There is a network problem, I think.
I think Vidya, maybe if Ritika is there, you should come in as a second, third speaker. You need get some of these people from EDP to help you now.
Yes, yes, I have 1 second, madam. Let me.
We can hear you now.
We can hear you now.
Better.
You carry on now.
Yeah.
Continue.
Okay, now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Great. So I was telling you about the difference between the service organizations and the manufacturing organizations. Service organizations, our products are mainly services, which are mainly experiences. So the perception is very important, and that could change the entire concept and assessment of quality. That's the first point. Second thing is our products are all like heterogeneous. It has to be customized to each and every patient. It's not one size that fits all. And the third difference is that we have lots of consumer involvement in the whole process from starting to end. So that means, and also we have lots of moments of truth. So that means like if we have something, some problem that comes up to the mind of patient or to the eyes of patient, the entire concept of quality changes. So with that in mind, let's see how the healthcare industry provides quality. In the sense, like we always try to upgrade our technology. We try to provide the best operational facilities for our patients. We also upgrade ourselves to the pharmaceutical products and the optical section. And we provide the best in the market. And we try to have the best personnel with us to provide the quality service to our patients. So mainly, in short, we all focus on the supply side of the chain. And this is all we designed to provide the provisions according to the clinical guidelines. And this is what we think the quality that we are providing to our patients. But there seems to be a mismatch in the quality interpretation among the patients and the healthcare providers. In the sense, there is something called a technical quality and there is something called functional quality. Technical quality, we mean the technical aspects of our clinical diagnosis and the investigations that we provide. We are all tuned to do this. Every time we take efforts to improve our technical quality so that we provide the maximal quality possible to our patients. But unfortunately, this technical quality results and the efforts we take to improve the technical quality are all with us, the service care providers and the administrators. It's not being shared with the patients. And even if it is shared, patients are not going to understand the technical jargons. What they want is that the end result of technical quality and the functional quality. So the functional quality, we mean the process of getting the technical end result. That is, that encloses the non-clinical aspect of the technical end result. Frequently, it's being neglected or ignored by the healthcare providers. We as healthcare clinicians, we are all taught to deal with the complexities of disease, but we are not taught in the interpersonal relations or communications with the patients, which we have to learn by experience. So that lies the whole problem. So patients' focus is on the functional quality, whereas we focus on the technical quality. So to put it this in this information in a two-dimensional way, this is what we think we are providing to our patients. We provide quite a lot to the patients. So this is what we all provide. Whereas a patient comes to the hospital with expectation, so which includes the clinical and the non-clinical expectations also. So this is what the patient wants. Look at the intersectional area. This is what the patient wanted and we also provided. The smaller this intersectional area, the more problem we have. Our aim is to improve this intersectional area to the maximum possible so that we stand out in the pack. So this is what we want to do. So in other way, like we need to have the input also the output, and we also need to concentrate the whole process so that we provide a holistic or integrated service to our patients, which also gets assessed by the patients. So we know this functional quality is quite complex, but how do we unpack this complex functional quality? There is only one way out. We need to understand the perception of quality from the patient's point of view. And to say this in one definition, it is just the difference between the expected service and the perceived service. So we have to improve this part of it. We have to fill in this gap to improve our service. There are many models and methods that are being described. The most famous one is a gap model, which I've shown here, which is proposed by Parasuraman et al. And there are other models like Yano's models and validated questionnaires also. To give you more clarity, let me share some of the analysis that we have done at iFoundation, Coimbatore. This is based on ServQual questionnaire, which is a validated questionnaire. This has got two parts to that. One is an expectation part. The other one is a perception part. And it validates about five dimensions of service quality. The beautiful aspect of this question is that we could alter to suit our own local needs. So this was a tool that we've used to assess this. We got 320 responses, of which 294 were complete. The response rate was quite high, 89%. In this group, we had about 99 new patients and 195 review patients. So this group also had the demographic profile is given here. 57% of our sample size is above 46 years. And we had 49% of patients from the general ophthalmology and 51% from the specialty clinics. So we had a good mix of patients from representing all areas of the clinics. So basically this assess five important dimensions of the service quality. One is the tangibles, the responsiveness, reliability, and assurance and empathy. So what did we study and what did we get to know from this study is that we had quite a good number of positive perceptions. To say the few, people were impressed about the error-free documentation. They were also impressed with the accurate information about the treatment, the methodical way of examination, and the responsive staff members. We did have some kind of negative perceptions also. By negative perception, I mean that the expectation is high and the perception is less. Most important and statistically significant negative gap was found to be an undue delay in providing the treatment, meaning our waiting time was quite high. And it's good to know that we have exceeded expectation in all the aspects of assurance. And moving from there, what we did was that we studied the present state, that is otherwise called as the assess state. We visually mapped everything, the value stream mapping we did from the patient's entry point to the exit point, identified our areas of bottleneck areas, and that is where we concentrated. And we also identified our individual waiting area from different clinics. When we look at this, most of the areas, except for this pre-cataract area, other than all the other areas were all sub 3 hours, which is good. Still, patients found this waiting time to be a little longer. And so we revisited our entire strategy. So from this exercise, what we got to know is that our operational strategy on waiting time, we revisited it, the process, the appointment strategy, and the process of monitoring, everything we revisited. We also understood that we had quite a good number of positive aspects which added value to our patient care. We got to know about our negative areas and our areas of improvement, and we are working on it. So overall, I would say this kind of exercise could be an indication of our commitment towards service quality at all levels. So as I mentioned, the assessment of perceived quality, we can use feedback surveys, which can be done with a validated questionnaires, or we could involve some of the private vendors, or we could develop one for our own internal use. We have one for our IP building, IP section. We can use a telephonic conversation, which can be done as a follow-up or follow-on activity. What is more important is we need to critically analyze this feedback surveys and patient satisfaction studies. It's not about the graphs, the movement of graphs, ups and downs. It is more about the process and what all we can learn from that data. So that is what we need to concentrate here. So for that, we need to have a dedicated team which can look into the process critically from entry to exit at each point and analyze and suggest changes which can improve our practice. And the practice has to be a dynamic one. It's not one-time process. It has to continue on. And there has to be a definite involvement of top management in the entire process so that quality becomes everybody's business. From chairman to doorman, everybody has to be involved in the process. So what should we concentrate actually? We should be concentrating on the hospital operations mainly, though the determinants are the tangibles and also the interpersonal communications. This is what we need to concentrate. Why should we concentrate? Because that is what is visibly seen by the patient and it's directly related to patient satisfaction. And it creates a positive word of mouth, which is an important form of advertisement. And it can be easily evaluated by the patient, unlike our technical quality, which we always do and nobody knows about it. Do we have any statistical backup to say that customer service is an important competitive advantage? Yes, that we do have statistical backup. But this is not directly from the healthcare industry. It's from different service industries. However, we can extrapolate these results to our own industry as well. So what we get to know is that 86% of customers, they say that they would want to pay more for a better customer experience. More important than this is 89% of customers, they have switched to a competitor after a bad experience. And 92% trust only the recommendations from friends and family over other forms of advertisement. And important to note is that 5% increase in your customer retention has shown to increase the revenues by about 95%. We definitely have to increase and improve our customer service to stay in the game. So we have talked about the importance of service delivery, but can it be a competitive advantage? We often use this term, but the competitive advantage, I mean that it is difficult for our competitors to imitate. How can we make our service delivery practice a competitive advantage? Only if we translate our organizational vision and mission to a sensible implementation program, which has to be unambiguous and it should have a clarity in the process. And we should also have the ability to learn and relearn from our own experience to improvise the delivery practice. So what I am trying to say is that we have to create value chain at each and every point of patient contact, from pre-service, point of service, and also the after service. And that has to be supported by the organizational culture, structure, and optimal use of our strategic resources, from finance to technology. So everywhere we have to be creating value chain. So our shift has to be from mere supply chain to a value chain creation, so that it becomes a real competitive advantage. But there is one last thing to the whole thing. That is our own investment of time and energy in establishing the best service delivery practice. Unless we do this part of it, like the in establishing the thing, the whole thing will not become a competitive advantage for us. So we have to do it. So stay on focus. Thank you very much for the wonderful opportunity.
Thanks, Vidya. You spoke very well and kept within your time and definitely brought us all the more to think that it is so critical that we look at different ways of looking at the ophthalmic industry. And today, service providing being a great advantage and optimizing it is something so important. I'm going to be asking, is Dr. Haripriya or Dr. Ashok with us?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to ask a question to Dr. Haripriya and Dr. Debashish in this session, and I would want Harshul to chip in too. Now, both of your centers, incidentally, are dealing with large numbers. So how are you able to manage quality and still keep moderate pricing and still have profit margins?
Yeah. Sir, do you want to go first?
Dr. Debashish?
Sir, you are muted. Yeah. Please unmute yourself.
Sorry. Yeah, the first thing is, unlike Aravind, we are a total paying hospital. So that takes care of the kind of shrug of our responsibility from the compassionate capitalism, and that keeps us more financially afloat. The second thing is about queue management, Chitra, you asked, and we have an appointment system, unlike Aravind. We have a minute-to-minute appointment system, and we spend 17 rupees per appointment. So that's quite a spend. And that helps a lot because mostly in this high turnover areas, you will see that patients are generally convenient moving around a particular hour of the day or a particular day or particular months. These are high months, these are low months, these are high days, low days, high hours, low hours. So this gradient is taken off. And then the queue management becomes more easier because there can be explained waits, there can be finite waits, there can be occupied waits. So essentially it becomes, and the intervention, if the waiting is less, I think like going to a spectacle or buying the medicines from the hospital or even going in for an intervention itself is facilitated. So these are a few touch points which I wanted from our experience. Yeah.
Very valid. Haripriya, you could even deal in a different way. How do you optimize your service providing in your massive setup? You must be having some kind of quality controls. How do you do that? We really look forward to listen to it.
So I think this talk by Vidya was excellent. And I agree with her that service quality is extremely critical. I think it's a very strong way of internal marketing. Even in the quality pyramid, one aspect which is there in the quality pyramid is patient-centric care. So once the patients come in, so we do have a lot of opportunity for us to get feedback from the patient, verbal, non-verbal. But also specifically, we do have questionnaires, we do have a focus group discussion with different staff groups. So, and whatever the feedback we receive, this could be through either a phone call or through SMS, and once whatever the feedback we receive, we try to share it with all the stakeholders, both good and bad. And also it's very important to share the positive feedback with the team that actually encourages them to do better, and the negative feedback as well. So with this feedback, it also becomes useful for us to, you know, enable change. You know, if some patients are complaining about the food aspect, for example, like repeatedly. So you know, you have to go back and check your, put your canteen area in place. So I think this feedback mechanism and, you know, this communication between the patient has to be more proactive. So the patients do take a lot of effort to come and tell us what they feel, but for us to take it up and, you know, follow it up becomes very important.
Thank you very much. Harshul?
Yes, ma'am. So I like Dr. Vidya's talk very much. And see, it is very important to be empathetic towards patient and give them a good perception. They should feel good, you know. That's what we were taught when we attended LDP session in 2012. When I was very, in 8 to 10 years of my practice, I learned that they told us that the first impression of our patient is when, you know, the door is open. So they should feel the warmth that time only, that yes, we have entered the right place. Then your reception is the place where they should get warm. So each and every step is crucial for your practice. And in a practice where, like in my practice, where only one or two consultants are there, we have a close practice. So patient always get a one-to-one attention, and you know, all their queries are solved in one place. Of course, Devashish sir and Haripriya ma'am, they are in a big institute, so their practice is different. But of course, you need to take care of all their, you know, the whatever they need, the patient, they should be fulfilled and they should feel good. You should be empathetic towards them. You should look into each and every small problems which they have.